Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Sunday morning service here in Rosemary Street, and also welcome to those watching online. We're delighted to welcome to our service the Village Community Chancel Choir, all the way from California in the USA. And most of you will have missed a wonderful concert here last night as part of their tour of Ireland, but you'll get a wee bit of a flavour of it as our service proceeds. Next week's service will be led by Reverend Chris Hudson, our minister in charge. And the following Sunday, the 11th, will be a special service for children and young people, which will feature the choir from Malvern Primary School and will be led by Reverend Cheryl Mabin. Today's flowers are from Kathleen Hines in memory of Jimmy. Thank you. And do join us for tea or coffee in the central hall after the service. We are here to love each other, to love our frail, wounded selves, to love our broken world, and to love its suffering people. Let us worship so that love will flow. Let's pray. Eternal God, let our music be a witness to your majesty and love, and remind us that you're always watching and listening from your throne above. May your presence and beauty be found in every note, and may the words that are sung reach the hearts of your people so that they may draw closer to you. May your Spirit guide us through every measure so that we may be the instruments of your peace and proclaim your glory with glad voices. We ask this in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Now, it's our chance to sing with hymn number 22 in the red hymn books. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation.
Thank you.
just have the one reading, and it's going to be a book that isn't often read in church. It's chapter 19 of the book of Leviticus. When you reap the harvest of your land, do not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. Do not go over your vineyard a second time or pick up the grapes that have fallen. Leave them for the poor and the foreigner. I am the Lord your God. Do not steal. Do not lie. Do not deceive one another. Do not swear falsely by my name and so profane the name of your God. I am the Lord. Do not defraud or rob your neighbor. Do not hold back the wages of a hired worker overnight. Do not curse the deaf or put a stumbling block in front of the blind, but fear your God. I am the Lord. Do not pervert justice. Do not show partiality to the poor or favoritism to the great, but judge your neighbor fairly. Do not go about spreading slander among your people. Do not do anything that endangers your neighbor's life. I am the Lord. Do not hate a fellow Israelite in your heart. Rebuke your neighbor frankly so that you will not share in their guilt. Do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against anyone among your people, but love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. When a foreigner resides among you in your land, do not mistreat them. The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself, for you were foreigners in Egypt. I am the Lord your God. Do not use dishonest standards when measuring length, width, weight, or quantity. Use honest scales and honest weights. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was just absolutely magnificent. Just over a week ago, I was in great company. There was eight of us around the table in an Indian restaurant in Salou. We had a great time. It was in the Costa Dorado in Catalonia. Well, there was eight adults and one toddler. The extended family was away on holiday. My two sisters, their husbands, my nephew, my niece, her husband and their son, my adorable great-nephew, and of course me. There were no jukeboxes or sports and TV or other loud distractions. We were able to indulge ourselves with good food, sunshine and conversation for some 3 hours or so. And to crown the event, the delightful waitress recorded the event on posterity. On camera. So I have this terrific photograph. It looks much better in the colour original of this happy occasion. Most of us probably have photos like that. Photos that record significant events in our lives that we can look back on later. Sometimes this can be quite poignant. As the years pass, we look at younger, fitter versions of the face that we see in the mirror each morning, and we recall the loved ones who have since died. It's great to treasure these memories. Recently I was sent a copy of another treasured family photograph. Excuse me. This one here. I can show it to you later. On the left, leaning into the picture, is a fine, young-looking teenage boy. His name was Lothar Berglas. And not long after this picture was taken, young Lothar left Germany on the Kinder transport to Holland. He stayed there for a few months before travelling on to Britain, and then he came to Belfast, where he was placed with a guardian family. We'll hear more about young Lothar soon. Lothar escaped from Nazi Germany, as did another brother and sister on the left here. They managed to make it to the United States. However, Lothar's dad and two younger brothers were not so fortunate. The Nazi authorities deported them to the Izbeka ghetto in Poland. Lothar's dad never got there owing to an unfortunate accident, as they called it, on the train. His brothers ended up as two of the many victims of Nazi barbarity in an extermination camp. And Lothar's mum was killed as she took refuge in a church that was hit when the RAF bombed Essen. I learned all this from Lothar's son, Larry Berglas, who lives in New York. He had heard that his late father had received a letter of commendation from a minister of this church and wrote to us to ask if we knew anything about it. Well, we didn't. We have no record of the actual letter, but it turns out that we do have a record of why the letter was written. This young lad was a hero. Far from home and family, though he was, in May of 1941, this brave youngster risked life and limb on behalf of this congregation in Belfast. Here's how the 1941 annual report describes it. It should be placed on record that following the large air attack of May last, our church building was only by the narrowest of margins saved from total destruction by fire. That it was so saved was due mainly to the promptness and courage of the Reverend W. Rowland and his refugee guest, Mr. Lothar Burglass. Learning by accident that Rosemary Street was ablaze, they at once set off for the church, telephoning our minister on the way. And when Mr. Wilde and his son arrived a little after 4 a.m., they found that Mr. Rowland and Mr. Burglass had already broken into the church and were at work with a stirrup pump. It was not until 6 a.m. that the proper equipment became available, and for 2 hours, while the flames became increasingly fierce, nothing beyond small stirrup pumps were available with which to fight them. Yet had these not been used, the church would totally have become lost. We extend our profound appreciation to Mr. Rowland and Mr. Burglass. There you have it. Tom Moore's History of First Church passes over it in a couple of lines, but it's clear that if it hadn't been for the courageous actions of this young Jewish refugee from Essen in Nazi-ruled Germany, this beautiful meeting house in which we're gathered this morning would have been lost forever. Isn't that a wonderful story? Whatever happened to this brave young man? His son Larry is very proud of his dad, and rightly so. After finishing high school in Belfast, Lothar emigrated to the US, where he adopted the name Lawrence. He joined the United States Army, and he served with the occupying forces in Italy after the war. When he was demobilized, he attended Fordham College and Fordham Law School. He taught social studies in a local high school, and was also a practicing attorney at law. Larry tells me, "I'm surely grateful for the kindness and welcome shown by the Irish, the British, and the Dutch to my dad during those horribly difficult years. The kinder transport kids had few options as destinations. Most countries didn't want them." This year we've seen that negative attitude re-emerge against folk fleeing persecution in Iran, war in the Ukraine, in the Donbass, in Yemen, and parts of Africa, just as it did regarding the kinder transport kids back in the 1930s. There have been pickets in Bangor and Carrickfergus, and in towns up and down the Republic, sometimes organised by unsavoury people. What is a refugee? According to the 1951 Convention relating to the status of refugees, a refugee is a person who, quote, owing to a well-founded fear of being persecuted for reasons of race, religion, nationality, membership in a particular social group or political opinion, is outside the country of his nationality, and is unable to avail himself of the protection of that country. Well, the infant Jesus had to flee into Egypt to avoid being murdered by Herod. So yes, by the standard of the UNHCR, Jesus was a refugee. And that brings me back to the passage of scripture we just read. When a foreigner resides among you in your land, do not mistreat them. The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself. When we treat today's refugees with kindness, when we love them as we love ourselves, we're not only following God's holy commandments, but the blessing may be shared among us. For example, if you listen to the Reverend Chris Hudson's account of the remarkable contribution that young Christian refugees from Iran are making to our sister congregation at All Souls. We here at First Church owe young Lothar an enormous debt of gratitude. He made an immeasurable contribution to the life of this congregation and this city by a selfless action in preventing the destruction of this sacred place. And until a few weeks ago, we knew nothing about it. He loved his new neighbours, our ancestors, as himself. Let us all do likewise. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, teach us the meaning of your commandment to love our neighbours and our enemies, and help us to obey it. Make us instruments of your love, which is not denied to the hungry, the sick, the prisoner, the refugee, or the enemy. Teach us to hate division and not to seek after it. But teach us also to stand up for what is right, no matter what the consequences may be. And help us to do it and do some work for peace for you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing further to God's praise in the words of hymn number 30 in the red hymn book, that is Immortal Invisible. Support the weak, help the afflicted, be filled with the Spirit, sing and make melody in your hearts to the Lord, and always give thanks to our God and Father for all his blessings. Go in peace. Amen.
This blessing that we are going to sing was written for us by composer and singing Diego. And just towards the end of the piece, it features